over the blue line, lost the puck in his skates, and Longelier-Perron will clear. Plays it to an open wing. Here's McKiernan jumping up on the rush. McKiernan tries a centering feed, knocked on the backhand wide of the net by Levesque. Levesque now battling, all three Redmen in on the boards. Advance to the point, there's DuPont. Over for McKiernan, slap shot, knocked down in front, doesn't get through to Abbott. McKiernan rifles it around the boards. Stopped by Abbott. Advanced by La Traverse up to Ireland. His pass out of the reach of the intended target and rolls into the McGill end. Rough game for Ireland in a rough season thus far. Only 9 points thus far this year, and this is 17th game. That's after he finished third in the CIS last year with 46 points. Here now come the GGs. Mitot centering pass, and that missed the net. Moran was down as Veropol back-checking crashed into his own goaltender. Now we're going to, I believe, have a penalty upcoming against the GGs as Belzile comes out of his own end. Belzile takes a shot that bounced off the shin pad of Leduc. Ottawa will touch up, and McGill will go to the power play for the second time this game.
Having converted on their first opportunity, they're going to have a second power play chance here, an opportunity to extend that lead. It's going to be Luc-Olivier Blain, who I thought had gotten a piece of Hubert Morin at the other end and potentially avoided a goaltender interference call. They did give him interference. I'm not sure if it was the same play or if it was against Genet just after.
Is just interference, not goaltender interference. So McGill to the power play. They are 1-for-1 this game with a goal by Francis Veropol. Here is Veropol with a long pass over to Alex Picard-Hooper, who couldn't handle it, and the GG's Touchette will clear.
That was a really good pass by Veropol there. I like that he's not necessarily looking to shoot first all the time, but really looking to make the best offensive play available.
Veropol's power play goal earlier in this game, his 9th of the season. That's the best in the OUA. Veropol settles it down. So prolific on the power play. Had 10 power play goals last year. Here's Dorian. Shot, rebound in front. Long play, Poirier first on the backhand, stopped, and then on the second effort, fired it up into the netting. And then a GG fires the puck, catches a McGill spectator right in the shoulder.
Well, as good as Francis Veropol is, he drew the double team there, and Marc-Andre Dorion was wide open, was able to create a scoring opportunity, a rebound there. Unfortunately, the goalie covered up.
Off the faceoff, McGill advances it. Their second unit out now of Vossen, Vachon, and Wright, with McKiernan and Dorion on the points, both of whom can really shoot the puck. There's a poor pass by Vachon, cleared out all the way into the McGill end. 50 seconds remaining on the man advantage. McKiernan chips it in, can't get around Miller, and first man to it will be Burns, and he will clear it on the backhand. Puck rolls down into the Ottawa end. Jalbert is the first man to it, gives it away. Here's Vachon. Circles out from behind the net, plays it to Dorian at the blue line. Dorian walks the line, fires, oh, he just hit the crossbar, thought that was in. Dorian rings it off the iron with a beautiful slap shot. I thought that went in.
I thought that was in as well. It wasn't really a hard sounding post, especially considering the laser of a shot that was.
Ottawa penalty has expired. McGill now 1-for-2 on the power play this game. That puck is fired in. Abbott out to play it. Bourgeois pinches and plays it down low for Longelier-Perron. He'll chip it behind the net for Levesque. In front. Tried to get it to Longelier-Perron. That's picked off by Mitot. He'll play it ahead for Blunden, and the GGs will be offside.
Well, now they've killed this penalty, the GGs have got to try to focus on getting back into this game. They need to get the next goal. I think it's imperative that they score to make it 3-2 before McGill can increase this lead even further. You mentioned they've lost three in a row. They don't want to make that four, certainly given how close the standings are.
As you said in the open, Trevor, 3 points separating fourth from ninth. And a game in hand, actually, the ninth place team, the Queens Golden Gaels, have, being just a point back of that backlog between Ryerson, Toronto, and Ottawa.
Exactly. So if Ottawa loses this game here, that gives them two games in hand, a chance to somersault, leapfrog them in the standings.
Puck is cleared to center by the Redmen as Chamberlain touches up. Couldn't handle the puck along the blue line, however. Here's Biniak for the Redmen, advancing down the right-hand side, flips a weak backhand in front. Abbott had a bit of trouble with that, but will cover up and take the whistle. 7:37 remaining here in the second period.
Abbott's been doing a good job tonight at controlling his rebounds. A lot of times we see a crowd of Redmen around the net. On that last power play, there was a rebound opportunity. He was able to cover it up just there. The forecheck was coming, and he's able to let his team regroup. They're going to get a change here. Despite the fact that they're down 3-1, he is making it easy on his defensemen.
Off the faceoff, Belzile takes the puck away from Beaulieu. Played it down for Verrill Paul, and he gave it away. Picard Hooper at center, can't get it past Blaine, and the Redmen will have to regroup. Verrill Paul back for McKiernan and up to Picard Hooper. He can't get it deep. As Jalbert will take over and feed for Beaubriel. For Blaine, and a quick touch pass to Hayes. Blaine out now, the GG's top scorer, with a pair of fourth line wingers. So an extra shift for him. He'll play it back to the line to Jalbert. On the half wall for Blaine. Gives it away behind the net, and Belzile will take over for the Redmen. Poor clearing attempt by Picard Hooper. And DuPont will now do battle with Forster on the boards. Picard Hooper took a hard hit from Blaine, and then Picard Hooper retaliating with a slash. Here's Verrill Paul down the right-hand side, fires a shot at Abbott, who backhands that and covers for the whistle.
There was two hits there that looked somewhat questionable. The second one there on Picard Hooper, the first one, well, either one could have been a boarding penalty. It looked like they were from behind. Definitely separation between the player and the boards. And the slash from Picard Hooper says he somewhat agrees.
Face-off won by the GGs, Latvavers. Plays it up the boards for Ireland. He's battling with Wright, and Wright comes up with it. Genet now at the point, rings it behind the net for Vachon. Leaves for a pinching Dorian. Dorian around the net, tries to stuff it short side, stopped by Abbott. Dorian leading the Redmen this season with 31 points, so dangerous when he pinches off the blue line. That pass eluded the Redmen. Slides all the way down into the Ottawa end. Abbott gave it away, bounces in front. Vossen stuffed at it. Looked to have it over the line. Abbott reached back, got it with the blocker hand, and the referees are going to say no goal.
I'm in shock. I don't know how Vossen didn't put that one home, or if he may have. The referee didn't have a good angle. It looked as though the GGs were turning up the other way to break out of the zone, and the referee was following them. All of a sudden, there's a turnover. The puck ends up dribbling towards the goal line. Vossen got a stick on it. Seemingly, it wasn't enough. Kelly Nobes thinks he saw it go in.
Referee Mathieu Bergeron was in a really tough position. He was at the top of the circles, trying to bust his way back in after a poor turnover by the GGs, and just didn't up the angle on the puck. To me, it looked in, but it was very close.
Yeah, it was very difficult to tell, and the referee also had Russell Abbott scrambling back into position, who is blocking his view of the goal line as well, made it even more difficult.
You know, Vossen kind of got away with one there, as it looked like he ran a bit of a pick on Russell Abbott as he was trying to get back to the net, so maybe justice is served in that respect. 5 minutes, 30 seconds remaining here to play in the second period. Redmen with a 3-1 lead. A couple close calls in the last few minutes. First by Dorian and then by Vossen. Puck comes loose to Genet. Shot, rebound to Levesque. Put it off the side of the net. Abbott might have got a piece of it. Longelier-Piron, watched by Jalbert, takes a couple hard cross checks, knocked to the ice, as Jalbert and Longelier-Piron have been going at it all game. Donovan over the blue line. Passes ahead to Touchette. He throws a backhander in, and Moran did well to get a skate out and stop that puck. A good chance for the GGs.
And Dorion did a good job to clear the rebound, get it out of harm's way. Good shift there by Longier-Poirier.
Veropol leaves the puck for no one as the GGs take over. Donovan with a hard shot. Moran was handcuffed a bit, but manages to lunge out and cover up for the whistle. To give due credit to Russell Abbott on that, was it a goal play a couple minutes ago? He did an excellent job scrambling back, getting his blocker hand behind him and pulling that puck off of the line.
Definitely. Whether it was in or not, we can never tell, but it was a great play to reach back and try to scoop it away. And evidently the referee believed it. He did a good enough job.
Face-off won by Picard Hooper. Puck advanced to center, and Picard Hooper will pick it up himself. Advances it into the Ottawa zone, taken away by Blunden, however, and Ottawa will start out the other way. Mettot throws it at the net from a sharp angle, and Moran will cover up. 4:21 remaining in the second period.
Aside from these last two shots, we haven't really seen much threatening from the Ottawa GGs in this second period.
They've really changed their style of play this season, Trevor. I mean, last year they were a very high-scoring team. They had, you know, three of the highest-scoring players in the OUA between Mettot, Blaine, and Ireland. This year, not scoring much, but much better defensively.
You know, they brought in new coach Royal Paimon, and that was one of his first missions, was to really instill a philosophy change. And that was to go, as you said, from more of a high-octane offense to more of a conservative defensive structure.
And it looks like we will have a penalty here off the play, as looks like Darren Miller is going to be going off for the high stick. And just to get back to Paimon for a second, former McGill student, played defense here for the McGill Redmen from 1983 to 1985, also spent some time as an assistant coach during his time here as a student. Prolific coaching resume, and he's done a really nice job with these Ottawa GGs. Was the first man to coach over 1,000 games in the QMJHL, coached the World Junior Team Canada squad back in 97, and he's really made a difference in a year, especially in the penalty kill and the defensive play of the GGs.
Definitely, and sometimes it takes a coach with a track record like Paimon's to come in and get the attention of the locker room, get his players to buy in, especially a young team like the Ottawa GGs. They had a lot of young players, you know, Luc-Olivier Blain and Kyle Ireland, Dominique Gilbert, they're all second-year players, and yet they are the leaders of this team. So to have a strong-willed coach like Royal Paimon behind the bench is very important.
Oh, I think that's exactly it. It is buy-in from the players. It is saying that we know you were statistical all-stars last season, but you're playing a better role for the team by being defensively responsible.
Exactly, and Luc-Olivier Blain, who leads the team in points this year, is a perfect example. He only has 25 this season, had 52 last year, and yet their record is better in this campaign.
McGill on the power play, minute 22 remaining. Picard Hooper sends it to the side of the net. Veropol can't stuff it by Abbott. Tried to beat him short side, and then his centering pass rolls all the way back out to center. Veropol will try again, stepping in over the top of the circle, cutting into the slot. Veropol fires a shot, blocked by Beaubriot, and Beaubriot will pick it up and clear the puck.
We seem to be giving Veropol a lot of time here tonight. Normally we see teams try to play him very aggressively, very physical, and that somewhat speaks to the conservative style of the GGs. They try to remain more structured as opposed to trying to hit everything that moves, but we have seen that that's a very effective way to get Veropol off his game. They're not doing that here tonight, and he has 2 points.
2 minutes, 30 seconds remaining to play in the second period. 30 seconds remaining in the McGill power play. Haven't managed to get much going yet. Second unit out now. Vossen plays it around the net for Vachon. Back to the line, McKiernan. Spins. Nice pass for Morse. And he'll play it down low into the corner for Andrew Wright. Around the boards for Vachon. Back to the point is McKiernan. Has a goal tonight. Now Morse. Vossen, the captain, back to the line. Morse walks the line, fires a shot, redirected, bounces loose in front, and Vossen scores. Evan Vossen as the puck sat behind Russell Abbott, pokes it over the goal line. This time it will count, and the Redmen have a 4-1 lead.
Well, he made sure that he got all of it that time, having missed out on a scoring opportunity on his last shift. Really put all the weight into that two-foot shot in order to make sure it crossed the goal line. And as you mentioned, now we have a 4-1 lead for the Redmen. I want to come back to McKiernan. He has been excellent here tonight, making little plays, but making them effectively and efficiently. There it was, getting the puck, moving it along the blue line, and that's how it ended up back into the corner, cycling around. It ends up on Voss and stick and in the back of the net.
So the Redmen with a 4-1 lead as Vossen picks up his 10th goal of the season from Vachon, and there should be a second assist on that play for Ben Morse. We'll wait and see if they give it to him, as it was Morse who took the point shot on the play. Now it looks like we'll have another penalty upcoming. I think it's going to be against the GGs again. And Trevor, you mentioned discipline, and that's been a huge problem for Ottawa thus far in this game.
Yeah, and it's sort of been the result of their frustrations as well. As they start to dig themselves into more and more of a hole, they're starting to take some penalties out of that frustration. There it was, an unnecessary hit behind the net. You had the Redmen outnumbered, could have played the puck and gotten it out. Instead, took him down, and the Redmen are going to get another power play opportunity, having scored twice already.
Well, that last goal actually just after the penalty expired. So McGill officially 1-for-3 on the power play, but in reality 2-for-3. If we're going to nitpick. So McGill with another chance, 1:05 remaining here in the second period with a 4-1 lead. Dorion settles it down, plays it for Picard Hooper, back to line to Dorion. Fires a long shot right on, rebound in front, Belzile couldn't get it. GGs can't clear, Picard Hooper plays it down low for Veropol. Back to line Dorion. Return feed for Veropol. 9 power play goals on the season for Veropol. Takes a one-timer, bounced. Believe it was redirected by Genet, possibly Belzile as well, but bounced wide. Scramble for a loose puck. Blaine gets just enough to get it to center.
Remember doing a really good job of rotating the puck around the zone on the power play, setting up open men.
Picard Hooper, hard around the net for right and back to line to McKiernan. Partial change for the McGill power play, 10 seconds remaining. Veropol for McKiernan. Fakes a couple of shots. Here far side, Veropol, his shot slides up high and over the net, and that will do it for the second period. So McGill gets a late goal from Evan Vossen with just under 2 minutes remaining to play in the period, and they have a 4-1 lead over the Ottawa GGs.
Yeah, a rather uneventful period there, only the one goal that came near the end, but that's what McGill wanted. If you're coming out of the first period up two, you want to come out at least with the same lead going into the third. They've extended it, and Ottawa's looked rather lifeless, especially towards the end of that last period, taking frustrating penalties, as we mentioned, the discipline issue. Currently, McGill's on their fourth power play. There's been a lot of chippiness just there at the end. Ryan McKiernan and Luc-Olivier Blais were exchanging a couple of hacks before they went to the respective dressing rooms. If the score continues to widen a little bit, we could see some fireworks here towards the end of the third period.
Well, you mentioned lackadaisical play from the GGs. Only 6 shots in that period for Ottawa for a two-period total of 11. 16 shots in that period for McGill for a two-period total of 24.
Well, Russell Abbott has done as good a job as he can do. He mentioned diving back into place to prevent Fossen's first attempt at a goal. But at a certain point, there's only so much a goaltender can do, and you're being outshot 24-11. You need your skaters to create something offensively, and they really haven't been able to get any sort of threatening play going.
So after 40 minutes, the McGill Redmen lead the Ottawa GGs by a score of 4-1. We will step out for the second intermission. Hope you'll join us back here in 15 minutes. After 40 minutes of play, the McGill Redmen lead the Ottawa GGs by a score of 4-1. Just one goal in the second period. Scoring summary brought to you by the Montreal Gazette. MontrealGazette.com is your source for local news and sports. And that goal was by the captain, Evan Vossen, his 10th of the season, banging a puck past Russell Abbott on a point shot by Morse that just snuck by the Ottawa keeper. Trevor, 40 minutes gone here. The McGill Redmen firmly in control, outshooting the GG 16-6 in that second period. Is there any hope for Ottawa for a comeback here?
Well, I'd like to say yes, but unfortunately it doesn't look good, only because they really weren't able to get anything going there in the second period. They had to play with some desperation towards the end of that middle frame if they were going to get back in this game. They weren't able to muster that that willpower, if you will, to try to get a goal to minimize the lead. If I'm McGill, you really want to focus on ramming it down their throats here, to be honest. You've had trouble sometimes playing a 60-minute game right here. You're going towards the end of the season. You really want to focus on being able to finish these teams out. This may be a team you face in the first round. So looking forward, it's important to almost sort of take away any hope they might have of beating McGill in a three-game series if it comes to that.
These two teams met in the first round last season, McGill sweeping the GGs in two games. Right now, Ottawa sitting in seventh, but as we mentioned in the open, only 1 point ahead of the ninth place Queens Golden Gales.
The other thing that's important for the Redmen here in the third period is to keep their cool. We've already seen sort of frustration start to escalate here on both sides. In a game that should be easily in control, you don't want to lose players for any games going forward.
Especially with a big rematch looming tomorrow against the Carleton Ravens. McGill on the power play to open the period, just 15 seconds remaining with the man advantage as Alex Picard-Hooper settles it down behind the net for the Redmen. Back to line, Dorian. Return feed for Picard-Hooper. He has two assists this evening. Takes a shot himself, rebound rolled out to Andrew Wright, who couldn't settle it down. No Francis Veropaul out there to start this period on the top line. There's a quick shot. Jeanne loose in front, and the Redmen can't bang it past Russell Abbott. Play is kept in at the blue line by Jeanne. He'll chip it on net. Steered by Miller up the boards. Donovan advances it into the McGill end. Andrew Wright flips the puck into the zone. Levesque is the fresh man on after a McGill partial change. Puck is handled nicely by Beaugrio, and he'll get it up the boards and out to center. McKiernan ahead for Longier-Péron down the right-hand side. Nice move. Cuts in. Tries to stuff the puck between the pads of Abbott. The Ottawa netminder making a nice play to stay with Longier-Péron.
Yeah, it's again good rebound control there by Russell Abbott. He shuts the door and makes sure there's no second chance opportunities. And he's done a good job of doing that all night long. Unfortunately, there have just been too many open chances for the Redmen. You know, Vossen had two cracks at it. We can debate whether or not he should have two goals here tonight. Veropaul's been given a lot of time and space. So he's been doing all he can to mitigate opportunities. And unfortunately, they just keep coming.
Big hit by Benoit Levesque as he ran over Thomas Beaugrio in the corner. Now Maxime Longier-Péron with it, throws it to the net, easily covered by Russell Abbott with the paddle down. And Trevor, I'm scanning the McGill bench and I don't see Francis Veropaul so Francis Veropaul was not out there for the first shift with the top line. I didn't see him, at least, but he does appear to be on the bench.
Well, that's good. You thought maybe he'd aggravated that knee injury we saw him suffer in the first period. He continued playing, but sometimes those things can swell up on you over the course of that middle period. Good to see that he's back there and that it's not an injury concern.
Big booming slap shot off the faceoff by Kevin DuPont. Russell Abbott sharp to stop that one. As despite letting in four goals, this has been a bit of a bounce back game for him. In his last start against the Concordia Stingers, he gave up five goals on 15 shots. There's another hard shot from the point, this time by Ryan McKiernan, who's already got one this game. Abbott there to stop that too.
I think that's his third or fourth shot attempt there for Ryan McKiernan, really having a great game. Coming back to the Ottawa GGs, they're trying to come back in this game here. I think the first minute and 48 seconds of this third period have all been spent in their end defending.
You are absolutely right, as Voyer now gets the puck out to center and will chip it in. McKiernan starting out, tried to advance it to right, will need to get some help. And that will be blown down on a hand pass by the GGs.
Well, the GG penalties are really what opened the door for the Redmen. Though they're only credited with a 1-for-4 on the power play, there was that second goal scored moments later. But despite not scoring on the other two opportunities, they were really able to pull momentum away from GG's early in the first and throughout the second.
Here's a backhand shot from Touchette. Blocker saved by Moran. Biniak now battles along the boards with Chamberlain. Gets some help from Donovan for the GGs. Miller throws it in front. Chamberlain swung at it. Puck didn't get through to Moran. Knocked down by Morse in front. Now in the corner, Touchette comes up with it behind the net. Centering pass. Gets to Donovan. That's poked off his stick. And here comes Biniak the other way for the Redmen. On his backhand, nice pass to Boisvert. Had a 2-on-1, but missed long play Poirier on the pass. Almost 3 minutes gone here in the third period. Spent almost entirely in the Ottawa end, as you mentioned, Trevor. McGill with a 4-1 lead, and Ottawa not looking like they can get much going.
I think it's important that the Redmen don't let up. They want to finish this game, maybe put a couple more home.
Here's Picard Hooper. Has Veropoul going to that, and he scores. Francis Veropoul, his second of the game on a beautiful feed by Alex Picard Hooper. And the Redmen have a 5-1 lead.
Well, those two players connect again. They each have 3 points here tonight. That's Vero Paul's second goal of the contest, as you mentioned. And not taking their foot off the gas pedal, the Redmen now have a 5-1 lead. And look at the team all going to say thanks to Hubert Morin for keeping them in it this far.
And it looks like the GGs will make a goaltending change as Russell Abbott is coming out. So into net comes Aaron Barton. Barton has a 5-2 record this season with a 2.32 goals against average and a .895 save percentage. He was awful in his last outing, letting in 4 goals on 8 shots against UQTR before getting pulled.
Well, he wouldn't be the first goaltender to give up a lot of goals to UQTR this year. They've been a very strong team from Russell Abbott. I'm frustrated. I put forth a pretty good effort here tonight. You know, mentioned his rebound control on numerous occasions. He really kept his game simple. Unfortunately, there were just a lot of grade-A scoring opportunities for the Redmen. And I don't think any of their goals you would have called soft goals. Maybe the deflection that ended up being the second goal. But other than that, they've all been very nice offensive plays.
You mentioned UQTR scored a lot this year. 113 goals thus far this campaign. They are a high-scoring team. Here's a chance for a 2-on-1 for the GGs. Metot shoots and scores. He kept it himself, had a 2-on-1 with Stephen Blunden as Metot picks the top right-hand corner and brings the GGs back within 3.
We made that one look easy. He cocked the leg as though he was going to shoot. Hesitated just a moment. It looked like Hubert Morin dropped his left glove hand ever so slightly, exposing that top left corner for Metot, and he didn't make any mistakes, making it 5-2. Here you have a 3-goal deficit. On the bench, you're telling yourself, if we can get another one here in the next 6 minutes before we hit the 10-minute mark of the third, we do have a chance to come back. But you've got to up the intensity level. You've got to start playing with desperation. And this isn't just a play to this game, but we mentioned they're on a 3-game losing streak. After this game, they only have 4 remaining. It's really important that they right the ship here and start to play with some purpose.
So Metot's 10th of the season brings the GGs back within 3. It is now 5-2. Redmen controlling in the offensive zone. Vachon tries to swing a pass back to McKiernan out of his reach. McKiernan will chip it in. That will roll all the way down to Barton, who will cover up for a whistle.
Again, first shift after the goal. The Redmen take it down, and they're controlling it in the Ottawa zone again. You'd like to hopefully have grasped that momentum if you're the GGs, having just scored, as opposed to having to defend again. Now they got their top line out there. I believe they're going to try to bring it the other way.
GG's advance the puck to center. Touchette gloves it down. Drop pass. Chamberlain fires a shot wide of the net. 4.5 minutes gone here in the third period. 5-2 lead for the McGill Redmen. Donovan has one of the GG's two goals this game. Gets it over the blue line. Stepping up, however, is Morse, and he'll flip the puck to center. Biniak skates onto it. Passes far side. Boisvert in front, and that was just out of the reach of Longpoy Poirier. Touchette to center. Chips it in. Ottawa makes wholesale changes as McGill will try to come the other way with speed. Morse, his return feed for Bourgeois is out of his reach. Bourgeois will chip it to center, however. Picard Hooper leaves for Varopal. Varopal's got two, looking for the hat trick as he skates behind the net. Back to the line to Dorian. His shot loose in front, and Picard Hooper couldn't quite stuff it by Barton as there was also a redirect by Belzile on that shot. Varopal comes up with the puck. Back to the line, Dorian. Steps around his man Voyer nicely, but they're stepping in to take the puck away was Ireland, and he'll shoot it down the ice.
That was a great play by Vero Paul to find Marc-Andre Dorion, and Dorion tried to step around the GG winger and set him up again for the back door. Unfortunately, he got the puck stripped and it went the other way.
Luke Blaine will have to cut back into his own end, throws a puck wildly up the boards, and Deneau plays it just offside, however, as it just cleared outside the Ottawa blue line.
We got some more action there after the whistle, and it's a good thing that Deneau's walking away. The GG defenders trying to entice them into doing a little bit of extracurricular activities after the whistle.
14 minutes remaining to play here in the third period, as Ryan McKiernan skates back into his own end to settle the puck down. Rings it around the boards hard to Levesque. He'll leave for Longelier-Perron. As McGill has matched up their checking line of Longelier-Perron, Deneau, and Levesque all night against Ottawa's top line of Blaine. Here's Longelier-Perron. Cuts the net. It hit off Barton and then was left at the side for Levesque, who puts it past Barton, and the Redmen have a 6-2 lead.
Well, as I mentioned before, Ottawa unable to get momentum back after scoring their second goal. Instead, McGill took it the other way and has been controlling play ever since. And there we see the checking line out, and they put home a goal.
And they've outplayed Ottawa's top line all game.
Oh, absolutely. You look to Blaine as a player who's been very offensive in his career. He's been almost invisible here tonight. The checking line has done a great job, as have the Redmen defensemen. We've talked about McKiernan, but Morse, Genet, Dorion, obviously as well, all have played excellent games here, keeping it simple and making the easy play all the time to get it out of their own end and launching the rush the other way. And we've seen a lot of rushes for the Redmen, lots of scoring opportunities, and they've put another one home here to make a 6-2 victory.
So Levesque from Longelier-Perron, Levesque's sixth goal of the season, just his third even strength goals. He has three shorties this campaign. Ottawa with the puck in the McGill end now. Chamberlain works it down low for Touchette. He overskated it, but will now get it back to the line to Cranville. Cranville, long shot, had a nice screen in front by Donovan, but he couldn't redirect it on Moran. Cranville down the boards. DuPont steps into him. Two big physical defensemen colliding there. Puck will come loose to Andrew Wright. He'll flip it down the length of the ice, and that just goes for icing.
You started to see the GGs turn on the forecheck a little bit there. It's unfortunate that we didn't see that earlier in the second period. You know, we know they're a defensive team that like to sit back, trap often. We've mentioned seeing the 1-4 formation a couple times on that last shift. Their second line was in there forechecking, trying to finish their hits, create opportunities. That's what they're going to need to do from the get-go when you're down 3-1, 4-2, as you have been here against McGill.
J.B. Voyer picks up the puck for the GGs. He'll play it back to Leduc. His pass will elude Morse and skip all the way down the ice. Bourgeois, first man to it. Plays the puck neatly up the boards to Morris and then ahead to Longpoint Poirier. Backhands the puck around Miller and gets it himself in the corner. Centering pass. Wavert just stuffed it wide. Biniak back to line Bourgeois. And around the net, that'll be out of the reach of Boisvert. Ottawa with a chance to clear, but can't get it past Morse. Beaubuil up the boards. It'll be played back to Leduc. And he will clear it to center to Longpoint Poirier. 12 minutes remaining here to play in the third period. The Redmen with a 6-2 lead over the Ottawa GGs. As Voyer tries to bring the puck in for the GGs, he can't get past, and White will have to regroup. Penalty upcoming against the Redmen, however.
I think it's going to be Boisvert on a slash in the neutral zone.
Luke Blaine gets the puck in over the blue line to Métot, cross to Blunden, and he will be the victim of an early whistle from the referee. Ottawa will, however, be going to the power play, believe for just the second time this, pardon me, the third time this game.
Well, I was about to compliment the Redmen fourth line for having had a great shift. You know, we applauded the third line earlier and they ended up scoring a goal. The fourth line's been very good tonight as well. Biniak has been great. You know, the penalty here obviously goes against that, but they've been engaging themselves physically and making it difficult for Ottawa to play against them.
So Boisvert for slashing, and Ottawa will get a power play trailing by 4 with 11 minutes and 15 seconds remaining to play. That puck dumped in by the GGs took an odd bounce off the backboards and I believe went up into the netting and out of play.
What makes that even more unlucky is it was shot in by a GG undeflected, so the faceoff is going to come out. And they're going to be forced to reset all over again.
This will be Ottawa's 11th power play opportunity of the season against McGill. They have not scored on 10 attempts thus far. So McGill doing an excellent job on the penalty kill against the GGs, an excellent job in general as they've killed 22 straight penalties coming into this one.
One thing that they're doing very well on the penalty kill is anticipating where the puck is going to go next. We see here in the neutral zone, they're making it very difficult for the GGs to get into the Redmen zone. That all has to do with being in the right position and anticipating where the pass is going to go.
And they read that one perfectly as it'll be cleared by Genet the length of the ice. And perhaps part of the reason for the success of the Redmen on the penalty kill recently, they've been a good team all season, but Marc-Andre Deneau returning to the lineup after missing the first semester, he's really given them an extra boost on that top penalty kill unit.
Well, definitely. There's a number of players who missed time early in the year starting to come back and have a big effect. You talk about Deneau as well, Biniak, Belzile. They're all starting to see key minutes. We're going to have another penalty coming up.
It's Levesque for a slash as he got Touchette in the hands. So Ottawa will have a 47-second two-man advantage.
Well, if there was any hope, it's this two-man advantage. If you can conceivably score twice here, once before the 47-second penalty to Boisvert expires, then you'll have a 5-on-4 advantage to try and get that fourth goal.
So Gilbert and Burns on the point. It is Touchette, Donovan, and Chamberlain up front for the GGs. Bourgeois, Vossen, and DuPont out penalty killing for the Redmen. 30 seconds remaining in the two-man advantage as Burns plays it over to Gilbert. Back to Burns. Return feed for Gilbert. He'll play it in front. Touchette down low, Donovan. And Moran slides over and makes the save. Gilbert winds, fires wide of the net. That'll bounce all the way back to the blue line to Burns. Plays it back for Gilbert. Down low, Donovan. A sliding DuPont cut off that pass beautifully. Loose puck in the corner now. Played back to the line to Gilbert. Over to Burns. Down low. That slap pass missed Chamberlain and will bounce off the end boards into Hubert Morin, who covers up. The penalty to Boisvert has expired. 1:08 remaining now on a 5-on-4 for Ottawa.
That was a great defensive shift there by Vossen, DuPont, and Bourgeois. DuPont went down to his knees to cut off the pass. We mentioned the prowess of the box earlier there. They had the triangle going, obviously, on the 5-on-3, just as effective.
off the faceoff. Mitot trying to get around Deno, can't. Deno can't clear, however. Cranville, far side for Mitot. Down low, loose puck, scramble in front as both Blunden and Blaine whacking away at it, but Moran manages to hold on to the puck and get a whistle.
Moran's been quite steady tonight. He hasn't been forced to make very many spectacular saves, if you will. I think he was tested much more in the Carlton Ravens game last week, but steady nonetheless and on his way to another victory.
A bold but probably correct statement there, Trevor, as Andrew Wright clears the puck the length of the ice. Also wanted to say quickly, Real Paymont took the timeout early in this game when it was 3-1. One of the downsides to that is Ottawa had their second power play unit out for the duration of that 5-on-3 as their big guns of Mitot, Blaine, and Blunden weren't on the ice. They are now, however, as here's Cranville shot. Moran well out of the blue paint in the white ice to make a nice save.
Yeah, I'm sure you would have liked that timeout on the 5-on-3. Not only to rest your guys, but to set a play.
Here's Leduc, long shot, redirected, bounces just wide. Nice tip by Cranville. There's a shot from a sharp angle. Mitot, loose puck in front. Moran manages to get on it with Blaine and Blunden whacking away. And now Blunden throws a hard left hand right to the face of Genet. Hubert Genet, none too happy about that.
Well, certainly not more chippiness after the whistle, though. Genet kind of started that when he gave a little chop to the shin pads of Blunden. When you're down 4 goals, a little chop to the shin pads is going to go a long way towards getting you smacked in the face, as Genet just learned. Hubert Morin had a great shift there. Just after I mentioned that he hadn't had to work too hard yet so far this game, there he had lots of commotion, lots of action going around the blue paint, and he was able to find the puck and cover up.
Excellent rebound control we've seen over the last couple of weeks by Hubert Morin. Here's a long shot by the GGs as the penalty to Levesque expires, and we are back at even strength. So Ottawa is 0-for-4 on the power play in this game as Longpré-Poirier comes in and roofs that puck. Christophe Longpré-Poirier scores to give McGill a 7-2 lead.
That was a beautiful shot. Very similar to Ottawa's second goal. He cocked the leg, waited just a second for the goaltender to make the first move, and then he put it roof daddy to make it 7-2 Redmen.
Sixth of the season for Christophe Longpré-Poirier, and they don't get any prettier than that when it comes to wrist shots.
No, they certainly don't. That was a beautiful shot. Knocked the water bottle off and extended that lead to 5 goals.
So Longpré-Poirier from Bourgeois and Nick Biniak is the scoring summary to give McGill a 7-2 lead with 7 minutes and 40 seconds remaining to play in the third period. The rout is on here at McConnell Arena. We haven't seen many of them as of late. A lot of tight games involving the McGill Redmen, but they are out in front in a big way and Ottawa is in trouble. Miller plays the puck down low for Hayes. Rare fourth line shift for the GGs here as there's a long shot by Leduc. Bounces down behind the net. It is Blaine, their first line centerman, who plays out with their extra pair of wingers as Ottawa has dressed 7 defensemen tonight. And against a team that rolls 4 lines as well as the Redmen does, playing just 3 lines can be tough.
Oh, certainly. When you got fresh legs coming against you, it's always going to be more difficult. And that's amplified when you've got the talent that the Redmen have up and down the lineup.
Vero Paul had a nice chance there, bidding for the hat trick. A good save by Barton to kick out the left pad and make the stop. McKiernan now at the point, plays it down behind the net to Picard Hooper, leaves for Francis Vero Paul. Vero Paul as Miller and Picard Hooper now exchanging shots behind the net. They're still going at it in front of the net. As Picard Hooper and Miller, that's not a trade-off the Redmen want to take as Picard Hooper and Miller now exchanging blows in the corner.
And Picard Hooper's got to be careful. He may have gotten the original penalty there as I believe the GGs had the puck and the whistle hadn't gone yet.
From what I saw, deserved the initial penalty. He seemed
definitely
to initiate that contact with Miller.
again, you got to be thankful almost that the linesman stepped in there. We talked about not wanting to lose important players to suspension going forward. Well, Picard Hooper is certainly an important player to this Redmen team, especially given the synchronism we've seen between him and Verrill Paul here tonight. They want to build on that as opposed to have either of them sit out games going forward.
Well, this has been a real return to form game for Alex Picard Hooper, as he's picked up 3 assists tonight. He'd really struggled thus far this season, had only 12 points in 13 games coming into tonight. 3 points tonight, looks to be back on track.
Definitely. And talk about the depth of this Redmen team. That allows you to pull out these close victories when players like Picard Hooper aren't playing up to their normal potential or out of the lineup with injury, as we've seen. Both Picard Hooper, Verrill Paul have missed games due to injury this year. It also allows you to win games in a multitude of different ways. You can win blowout 7-2 when your big guys are going strong, and you can also win games 3-2 or 1-0 in a shootout as long as you're winning those dirty battles in the corners.
So Alex Picard Hooper gets the extra penalty, and Ottawa will go to the power play as there was a shot from Pat Burns with Luke Blaine in front, but Moran gloved it and held on.
It was great concentration there by Moran, as I believe the point shot was deflected, came right to the stick of Blaine, but Moran was there to make the glove save.
We'll see if Ottawa can get something going on the power play here. They're 0-4 this game, 0-12 on the season. Here's Deneau with a chance, and coming out to play the puck was Barton. Otherwise, Deneau was in on a breakaway. Referee got knocked down as he collided with Burns out in the slot. L'Angelier Péron had a chance but couldn't get a shot off. Here comes Ottawa the other way as Mitot cutting down the right-hand side. Cuts towards the net. Took a hard slash from DuPont that broke that play up. DuPont now trying to rag the puck along the boards. It's poked loose. Back to line to Burns and down low for Luke Blaine. Return feed for Burns. Far side. Blunden will settle it down. Blunden, Blaine, and Mitot. Mitot will be the net presence. Burns for Jalbert. Back to Mitot. He kicked out into the slot, and a lovely sliding save by Hubert Moran as Mitot tried to beat him 5-hole, but Moran closed that down in a hurry.
Well, great save there by Moran, but more great penalty killing from the Redmen. They're very sound in their box structure on the penalty kill, often creating scoring opportunities going the other way, even as we saw earlier in the shift. They do like to play aggressive on the penalty kill, but that does not mean that they're running around with their heads cut off by any means. They're able to play aggressive because they trust in their system, and they know that if one winger pinches in the neutral zone, the rest of the teammates going to be there behind them to back them up.
Also very good on faceoffs are the McGill Redmen. Vachon won that one, and that's cleared all the way down the ice by Genet. 45 seconds remain in the man advantage for the GGs as they trail 7-2 with 5 minutes remaining in the third period. Genet's the first man to it, but can't clear. Leduc will settle it down for Ottawa at the point. On the half wall for Chamberlain. Down for Touchette and back to line to Cranville. Cranville's pass handcuffed Leduc will slide past him and out into the Ottawa zone. Leduc carries the puck all the way up ice. Drop pass. Donovan gets it. Has Leduc going to the net, and a sliding save by Moran as he slides over and robs Leduc at the back door.
That was a great play by Donovan to set up Leduc coming across the middle of the ice. And even better goaltending by Moran to read the play, stay with it, and make that save look very easy. For it was really a great athletic play by Hubert Moran.
Put himself in position, didn't know he'd stop the puck as he looked behind him, but managed to keep this game a 5-goal lead for the Redmen. Here's Wright the other way, tried to flip it ahead to Longplay Poirier, pass didn't get there. GGs will clear. Bourgeois plays it back to Morse and up for Longplay Poirier. He'll chip it in and Barton is out to play it. Verrill Paul down the boards, takes the puck away, leaves for Boisvert, but then he plays it right into, that was Ireland as he got hammered by Verrill Paul, and then McGill had a chance going the other way.
Well, I'm very pleased to see the Redmen not letting up again here. You got a 5-goal lead, 3 minutes and 30 seconds left, and yet your top line continues to pour on the offense, trying to get even more goals here. have a stats night for everybody.
McGill has now killed 25 consecutive power plays. They've held Ottawa off the board on five-man advantages thus far this game, as we're going to get another penalty against the Redmen, as Francis Verropal will be going off for roughing. Little too aggressive there from McGill.
A little bit. But you're coming back to the penalty killing. You mentioned 25 in a row. That's another thing that allows you to win a lot of close games, as we've seen them do this year. Sometimes specialty teams are often the difference in those games. A couple power play goals here and there swing momentum and can decide the outcome of a game. But when your penalty killing is as sound as the Redmen have been, you're going to come out on the better side of a lot of those decisions.
And a lot of nice things to highlight for the Redmen in this game, as they have put in a convincing performance after being ranked first in the CIS top 10 poll, as it looks like Ottawa is going to be getting a penalty here as we'll go back to playing 4-on-4. And Trevor, just to talk about that for a minute, McGill will be ranked second behind University of New Brunswick for each of the last 8 weeks, now ranked first for the first time since February 2006, partially a reflection of the fact UNB has lost 4 of their last 5, but also just a reflection of how deep and how strong this McGill squad has been over the last few years.
Oh, definitely. You could have made the argument that they should have supplanted University of New Brunswick a couple weeks ago, but it's obviously the reigning CIS champions. They defeated McGill in the CIS final last year. Hard to unseat them at that point, but McGill has been dominant this season, especially of late, and with New Brunswick struggling, they finally reclaimed that top spot.
Luke Blaine with a long shot blocker down by Hubert Moran, and he's a big reason why they're ranked number one. Here's Maxime Longier-Péon with a breakaway. Deeks, and a nice save by Barton, sliding over with the right pad, stuck it out, and stopped Maxime Longier-Péon on the breakaway.
A beautiful play by Longier-Péon. He had Barton down and out. He's looking to the skies right now. He wished he'd lifted that one only slightly, only to get a couple feet under it. Would have had the 8th goal here tonight for the Redmen. But good to see some open rushing here with some 4-on-4 play.
He's so big and so strong, as Maxime Longier-Péon had a real coming out party last year at Nationals when he was named to the National Tournament All-Star team, as the rest of Canada got a taste of why he is such a dominant shutdown forward, as well as an offensive threat. Here's Longpuy Poirier trying to make this into a 2-on-1, but a nice back check there by Carl Hayes takes him down. Gilbert comes up with it for Ottawa. 2 minutes and 30 seconds remaining here to play in the third period. Forster over the McGill blue line. Can't get around McKiernan, as Ryan McKiernan will poke the puck away and start out for McGill. Nice game thus far for the White Plains, New York native. As Ryan McKiernan's had one of his better outings. Here's Boisvert, centering pass, rolled off the stick of Biniak. Couldn't get a shot off. Biniak comes out of the corner, plays it back to Dorian. He tried a return feed, bounced off the skate of Forster. Now Dorian flips a weak shot on net, and the net will be knocked off its moorings as Burns and Boisvert collide into the cage.
Well, you mentioned Longier-Péon with the goal there. A lot of times what happens on a team that's as deep as McGill is you have players who were offensive threats in junior, did all the scoring on their teams then. You come to the Redmen where you might be a little bit lower on the depth chart, and you're asked to be a checker as opposed to a scorer. And a lot of them are buying into Kelly Knob's system and doing what they've been asked to do, what they've been told to do within that system. But you always know that the talent's there for an explosive play, as we just saw.
Long attempted pass by the GGs, as it looked like JB Voyer was trying to spring Matt White, but that pass was out of his reach. And it's really been the play of the it's really been McGill's play defensively and in goal that has improved from last year. They're not scoring as much bar tonight as they did last year. Averaged about 5 goals a game last year, about 3.5 this year. But it's been their defense has been stellar, and their goaltending has been excellent.
So their goaltending definitely has been excellent. Defense is also very much a team concept as well. We mentioned, you know, we've got Vero, Paul, Picard, Hooper not scoring at the same rate they were last year, but that's because they've bought in to a more defensive style of play. And so they're seeing the wins still racking up, but by closer margins of victory, as we mentioned, far less 7-2 victories this year for the Redmen and far more 4-3, 5-4 games. And that's the sort of style that you're going to need to play in the playoffs. And Kelly Nobes, we talked to him, he said, I want to win the last game of the season. That's what's most important. The regular season, yeah, it's great to finish first, but in reality, everything is building towards the playoffs, wanting to win the OUA, wanting to get to the CIS final, and hopefully take that championship away from New Brunswick this year.
Well, McGill has made nationals 5 of the last 6 seasons. They've won the Queen's Cup in 3 of the last 4 years, but yet to win a national championship in the school's history. Last minute of play here in the third period. McGill with a 7-2 rout of the Ottawa GGs as Burns keeps the puck in for Ottawa. They'll try to get one more on the board here late. Belzeal advances the puck for Longpre-Poirier. He'll come over the blue line, fakes the shot, and then had the puck roll off his stick. Couldn't get a shot away on Barton. Belzeal cutting to the net, tries to thread one through the 5-hole of Barton. Nothing doing there either. Belzeal spins and deals the puck back to Longpre-Poirier, leaves for DuPont, and his slap shot deflected wide of the net. 15 seconds left to play as the Ottawa GGs will drop their 4th contest in a row in those 2 forfeited games earlier this season, looming large now as they drop to 12, 11, and 1 on the season. The McGill Redmen win again at home, and this time win convincingly. They improve to 18-2-2, defeat the Ottawa GGs by a score of 7-2, and celebrate in style as the number one ranked team in the nation.
And they reclaim first place in the OUA East Division as Trois-Rivières had tied them at 36 points apiece. Now McGill moves ahead by 2 points and still maintains 2 games in hand over the University of Trois-Rivières. And a big win going forward. We mentioned last week you had a struggling team like Carleton come in here. We're going to see them again tomorrow night. But they give McGill a very tough contest. Obviously, McGill came ready to play here tonight. There was an unlucky goal early on for Ottawa to give them a 1-0 lead less than 2 minutes into the game. But McGill stormed back, scoring 3 in the first period to make it 3-1 going into the second, where they got another one, made it 4-1. And obviously here in the third, we see a 7-2 score as our finale. Great game all around, but especially for Vero Paul and Alex Picard Hooper, each picking up 3 points and really showing that they are a first line to be reckoned with going forward. We haven't seen the same explosiveness from them as we've seen last year. We have mentioned that before, but they were in full force here tonight.
A bounce-back game for McGill's big duo of Vero Paul and Picard Hooper, as you mentioned, Trevor. As for Ottawa, not an impressive game for them. They were thoroughly outplayed all game long, and things don't get a lot easier for them. They've only got 4 games remaining on the schedule. They play Carleton, Concordia, McGill, and Trois-Rivières. They have to be looking with trepidation at the teams below them, Queens and Ryerson, who could surpass them and leave Ottawa on the outside looking in come playoff time.
Yeah, and you mentioned the schedule. That's a tough 4 remaining games. You got to face the top 2 teams in the division as your final 2 games of the season. You mentioned the loss. They now have 25 points in 24 games. Queens has 2 games in hand on Ottawa now,
and
with
Queens
a chance to supplant
them.
Queens
up 2-1 on Ryerson right now.
Oh, there you go. So if Queens is able to hang on to that, they will pass Ottawa and move into 7th. Ottawa, barring whatever happens with Ryerson's next game, could find themselves in 9th and all of a sudden on the outside looking in. As we mentioned, the standings are very condensed. It doesn't take much for you to go from 9th back to 7th or from 9th even to 4th or 5th. But with the schedule that you mentioned, having to face McGill and Trois-Rivières each one more time, and Concordia as well, it's going to be difficult.
Next game for the McGill Redmen comes tomorrow at 7 p.m. as they travel to Ottawa to take on the Carleton Ravens. We saw a great game here last week between those two teams, Trevor. We expect more of the same tomorrow night.
Definitely. I think if Carleton can bring the same style of the play that they did last week tomorrow, with McGill playing the back-to-back, it could be difficult for them to play as intense of a physical game as we saw last Friday. I think that's one thing that Ottawa wasn't able to do here tonight. Obviously, they're a more conservative team. They like to trap. That's their style. However, I really think against McGill, you've got to play physical. You've got to hit their defensemen at all costs, and you've got to put pressure on them, make it more difficult for them to make their decisions. We saw here tonight, they were able to get out of their zone with pretty, you know, quite fluidly here tonight. Dorion had a great breakout that led to the second or third goal for McGill. And all night, McKiernan, Morse, Genet, they were clearing the puck very efficiently, largely because the forecheck wasn't as strong as it was last game.
That game tomorrow will be available on SSN Canada, thanks to our counterparts at at Carleton University. So a big game for the McGill top line. All three of Belzile, Vero Paul, and Picard Hooper finished with 3 points each. As we wrap, Trevor, anything else you'd like to add on tonight's game?
I think we saw really the McGill team that we hoped we'd see this season tonight. They didn't do anything overly spectacular despite putting 7 goals in. You know, you somewhat come to expect some of the plays that we saw from Picard Hooper and Vero Paul here tonight based on what they'd done in the past. We just hadn't seen that develop yet this year. I think this victory, you know, the depth, lots of players got involved. The third line had 2 goals. The fourth line had a goal. Everyone was really clicking on all cylinders. And despite the fact they looked disorganized slightly in the first period, they got together and were all on the same page going forward.
I'd like to take a moment quickly to thank our sponsors for this season of Redmen Hockey on SSN. It is brought to you by Domino's Pizza, pizza that's made fresh and arrives fresh. That's our guarantee. Visit us online today at dominoes.ca, and by Ye Olde Orchard. With 4 locations in the greater Montreal area, Ye Olde Orchard is your neighborhood pub. Come visit us at 20 Prince Arthur West near the stadium after all Redmen home games. So on behalf of my color commentator Trevor Drummond, my name is Matt Chesser, saying thank you for watching and good night from Montreal.